We are live.
A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to iFocus Online, Lecture 224, number 11 from our series on Squint and Pediatric Ophthalmology. Today, we have with us Dr. Jitendra Jethani, sir, from Baroda Children's Eyecare and Squint Clinic, talking to us on evaluation of binocular vision and stereopsis. I request Dr. Pradeep, Sharma, sir, our chair for the evening, to please welcome our speaker for today.
Thank you, Dr. Shefali. It's always a pleasure to have Jitendra talking and listening to him. He's one of the most accomplished, although very young, and still a very great accomplished strabismologist and a practicing surgeon. So he is going to talk on the evaluation of binocular vision and stereopsis. He is currently the director of Baroda Children Eyecare and Squint Clinic. He did his MBBS from Ahmedabad BJ Medical College, and later on, he did his FNB in Pediatric Ophthalmology and Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai. Short-term fellowship in Pediatric Ophthalmology and Strabismus from Wisconsin University of Medicine, Dr. Kushner. Then he has done, he's been the head of the Pediatric Ophthalmology and Strabismus at the Thakur Bhai V. Patel Eye Institute. He has to his credit 58 scientific publications in peer-reviewed index journals. He has presented more than 120 scientific presentations and delivered lectures at various states, national and international conferences. He is very much interested in innovations, and that is what I always like about him. He's very, very energetic and a very good speaker. And now we will listen to Dr. Jitendra about evaluation of binocular vision and stereopsis. Over to Dr. Jitendra.
Thank you so much, sir. It's always a privilege to share the stage with you, and it's an honor. You have been a mentor to most of us in the country, and I am also one of them. I could work only for a very small time with you, but they are moments which I treasure a lot. So thank you so much, sir. And I would like to thank Dr. Honawar for giving the opportunity to speak on binocular single vision evaluation. And as I was discussing with Sharma, sir, this is indeed the ultimate goal of most of us, because third dimension of vision or 3D vision is what is part of binocular single vision. So let us briefly see what exactly do we mean by binocular single vision. So obviously you can see from the picture that binocular single vision is the ability to use both eyes together to achieve a single fused perception, a single fused image, even in the presence of disparity of the image. So this disparity of the image of the two eyes is what gives us stereo acuity. This particular disparity in the pannum's area is what gives us the 3D vision. And when these two single disparate images from two eyes are fused together, we get what we call binocular single vision. And these are, old with fused with new concepts, the Horopter concept and Wieth-Müller circle. So this was what was proposed, that this particular circle passes from the nodal point. These are multiple points, and the circle which is made was known as Wieth-Müller circle. But then it was found that it was actually a more broader or more horizontal kind of Horopter which we see. And between the Horopter, you have a pannum's fusional area where the two images would lie. And that is what is the relative disparity between the two eyes, as you can see here. And this is where we get most of our binocular or our 3D perception. So how does it, why it is very important is because it actually gives us the insight into etiology of strabismus, the type of strabismus that the patient has. It obviously makes us think about what should be the surgical plan, and we can also give post-op prognosis to the patient. So broadly, the first attempt, or the very good attempt which was made way back, I think in 50s and 60s by Claude Wirth, was he tried to demarcate what are the grades of binocular single vision, and he demarcated as simultaneous macular perception, fusion, and stereo acuity. And so these are the three grades of binocular vision. And nowadays, I went through some of the articles when I was preparing for this lecture, and I found that now they say that there are five grades of binocular single vision, which are basically very close to the conceptual three grades, which are simultaneous perception, and then superimposition. And then there is fusion, which is sensory and motor. And finally, the highest seat of binocular vision is stereo acuity. And what do we need for this particular binocular single vision is that the image should be falling on the corresponding retinal elements, and we will see what is NRC and ARC, and image should be very close to each other. They should be very similar in shape and size. Otherwise, it would be very difficult to, very difficult to fuse the two images. Now, the difference between fusion and stereo acuity is that in fusion, corresponding retinal elements are stimulated, whether it is NRC or ARC, but there are corresponding retinal elements which are stimulated. And here, corresponding retina, but they are non-corresponding because you get to have, it is in the same horopter, but these are disparate elements. Motor system is required, motor system is not required here. This will be two dimension and this will be three dimension. In fusion, it will function equally well for all fixation distances, but stereo acuity beyond 600 meters, it is very difficult to still have a good panense area. And so obviously in fusion also, there will be differences when the distance increases, but it will function even for a distant object. Fusion can occur without stereo acuity, but without fusion, it would be very difficult to have a good stereo acuity. Maybe, so you cannot really have good stereo acuity without fusion. And for fusion, there can be horizontal, vertical corresponding retinal points. So you can have horizontal fusion and vertical fusion, but stereo acuity occurs only with horizontal disparity because the horopter is such that, it is the same horopter when it comes to the vertical area. So it is very difficult that you have any sort of vertical stereo acuity. So most of stereo acuity that we have would be horizontal because the two images will be horizontally apart, our two eyes are horizontally separated. And so we will have the horizontal diplopia only. Our eyes are not separated vertically. We cannot have vertical stereo acuity. So a small point here between confusion versus diplopia, it is very important because when we talk about binocular single vision, we would be talking about mostly about diplopia. So we should be knowing when we talk about diplopia, basically we are talking about two points which are non-foveal. So there is a foveal point and then there is a extra foveal point which is also projecting an image, whether nasal or temporal, but it is an extra foveal point. And when both the retinas will be there, then both the foveas are there, then there will be confusion, which means that the two images will be fused, the two objects will be fused as a single image. Now it is very difficult that confusion can be actually seen. So it is very difficult for the patient to understand the confusion. And so most of the patients would end up into having double vision where a foveal and an extra foveal point is seeing a single image, which is being seen as double. So to remove this particular problem of confusion and diplopia, we have got two disposal mechanism, which is suppression and finally amblyopia, which means that there would be some suppression because there is a double image or there is confusion. And second is anomalous retinal correspondence. And finally, that may go into eccentric fixation, but these two points are completely different. Suppression is binocular, amblyopia is monocular, and ARC is binocular, and eccentric fixation again is monocular. So these two points, these two terms should not be used interchangeably. They are completely different from each other. Amblyopia is when one of the eyes has poor vision, even when the other eye is closed, whereas suppression is purely binocular when both eyes are open, one of the eye or one of the images of that particular eye is not being projected in the brain and is just being suppressed. So this happens mainly in visually immature children, and in adults, it is very difficult to have this and patient complains of double vision. So this is what I was talking about, active central inhibition of the confusing image, which is originating from retina of the deviated eye, that would be suppression. And the fovea of fixating eye would acquire an anomalous common visual direction with a non-foveal point, which is peripheral retinal area of the deviated eye, which receives the same image. Now this, if there is a complete adaptation, it is known as harmonious ARC. And if there is incomplete adaptation, so the way I try to explain these two points is that if you have an extra foveal point and the image which is at the extrafoveal point, the amount of this particular ARC or adaptation is equal to the amount of deviation, then it is total and complete adaptation. This particular new point is in complete sync with the other eye fovea, and so it is harmonious ARC. And if there is incomplete adaptation, it is in between fovea and the extrafoveal point, then it is unharmonious ARC. So basically, we come to the point now, the test for sensory status. So how would we test for these particular things? The only way to test is either we will have a foveo parafoveal, and that is the reason why I was talking about confusion and diplopia, because when we will be checking the sensory status, we will be using these two methods only. One would be foveo parafoveal or extrafoveal method, which are red glass test, Worthford dot test, Bagolini and Maddox-Rudd test. And then the other thing is foveo-foveal test, which is nowadays more or less, I have not seen the foveo-foveal test of Kuppers. So the only test which I have seen is after image test on a synoptophore or a major amblyoscope. So we take up with foveal, extrafoveal test. So the first one is red glass or red filter test. This would require patient's cooperation because he has to understand that there is a red light. So the moment you put a red glass in front of one of the eyes, the patient would be able to see that one of the light is red if he has diplopia, and the other is white or yellow light, depending on which color of light you're holding. So patient's deviation is first determined objectively, which means that patient has no say in that. And then the test is performed with the same fixation distance. If there is a heterotropia, which means there is a manifest angle, we would place the red filter in front of the habitually fixating eye, and then patient would be looking at a small light source. Patient would immediately tell you what he is able to see. So these are the typical responses. So this is very similar to the diplopia test or diplopia charting, except that in diplopia charting, you would be having a red-green filter. Here you are using only red filter. So one of the image, this is the fixating eye. So this would be in the center. And if patient has esotropia, there will be uncrossed diplopia. So the light would be on the other side because this particular light is on the nasal retina, and this in the brain has temporal aspect. So the nasal retina can see on the temporal side. And so he would feel that this is on the right side. So that is what is uncrossed diplopia. And if it is exotropia, patient would see cross diplopia. And then it depends on whether we are using a 5-prism base up or base down. To check for NRC and ARC, we can use a 5-prism base up or base down to check what happens depending on how big a prism we are using. So this is where we are trying to map out this scotoma. So if the patient is not able to see or he's suppressing the image, patient will not able to see this. And the moment you put a prism, that particular light would go out of that suppression scotoma, and then patient will be able to see that particular red light. Now the other test is Worthford dot test, which is you have four lights. There are two green, one red, and one is a white light as shown in this particular image. Patient is wearing red and green glasses. By tradition, we make sure that the right eye wears the red glass. It should be done for near and distance. And then once he wears this, if there is left eye suppression, obviously he would see two red lights. This is the normal response. And this is what happens when he has left eye suppression, right eye suppression, and diplopia. Now, this video I tried to show because, you know, we normally are not able to know what patient is able to see. So here what I have done is I have tried to take a video where I'm trying to use the green filter. This is what will happen if there is right eye suppression. So left eye would see three lights. As it is visible in the video, left eye is seeing the three lights. And then if you use the red filter, which means that left eye is suppressed and patient is seeing only with the right eye. So what will happen is patient would be able to see only two lights, and those two lights would be red. Now you put the red filter, you can see only two lights. You can see that the green lights are gone. So this is the actual patient response, and patient should see this. One important point here is that, you know, you should always check your particular work for dot test with the red green glass that you are using, because nowadays the different companies, they use different filters and they may not be really the same filter, and it is possible that patient actually sees four lights with any one of the eyes. So that you should do before you move on to doing a work for dot test. The only problem is that this is a highly dissociative test, because we are using red and green glasses to dissociate, not to dissociate the two eyes, but to find out his binocular condition. So we are dissociating the eyes with red and green glasses. And so eyes are getting easily dissociated if there is an unstable binocularity. Sometimes we are asked that whether a colorblind person can do a work for dot test. He may not be able to tell you the colors, but he can easily tell you that there are two dots or three dots. And that is the beauty of the test, that if the patient has to just tell how many dots are there. The only problem is it is at the end of the day a subjective test. And so if patient knows what is the response, he can, he can malinger. So a better test than work for dot test, which is similar to work for dot test, but is more physiological, is Begonini striated glasses. And the striations are at 45 and 135 degrees. And so this is the classical response of Begonini striated glasses. There is a central light and there is a X, which means that there is binocular single vision. And again, depending on which particular eye has which striation, if there is left eye suppression, the patient will see only one particular line. And if there is the other eye suppressed, patient will see other line. And if there is a central suppression, patient would see one as a complete cross, except that there will be a small gap in the central part. The difference between Begonini and work for dot test is that Begonini is better because it is more physiological. You can see through the glass. You can, as an examiner, you can judge the eyes as well. The patient can see in free space. So he can use his little bit of fusion if he has a subnormal fusion. In Begonini, we can also use some prisms to correct the tropia. We can check for cyclotropia also. So these are some of the advantages of Begonini striated glasses. But work for is equally good test. Another important or very commonly available thing is Medox rod in our trial set. And this is also very useful for phoric patients. We can put it horizontally and then there will be a vertical line. So this is patient's response from one eye, he is able to see the light in the center. So this is a fixing eye. And this is basically phoria. So you are asking whether, there is uncrossed or cross, or you can ask whether the line is on the right side or the left side, and you would be able to know whether it is esophoria or exophoria. This can be used for near and distance. A little bit of trivia with Medox tangent scale, I've not put up the photograph of that, is that, it was classically used for 5 meters. And normally we are asked the question why it is used for 5 meters. And it is given in Duke Elder that, Medox, the actual Medox room was 5 meters long. And so he initially designed it for 5 meters only, not for 6 meters. As we traditionally see, most of our ophthalmological equipments are designed for 6 meters. Medox wing, not very commonly available nowadays, but it is a wonderful piece of equipment. The beauty of it is that, you can see this is the interpretation, or this is what the patient actually sees. It is very, it is very nicely done. This is the arrow. It is at zero. This has been, it is devised in such a way that right eye only sees these things and the left eye sees only arrows. So this is how they have separated the two, separated the two things. And you can see zero here for hyperphoria. This is left hyperphoria. So you just have to ask the patient whether it is even or odd, and you can find out whether it is esophoria or exophoria, and whether it is right eye hyper or left eye hyper. Such a genius and such a nicely designed instrument. And then we come to more of haploscopic tests, more of foveofoveal tests. So the major difference between these two tests is that foveofoveal test means that there will be two test objects which will be presented to the two fovea separately. And so patient would be dissociated. Like in after image test, what we do is we will be presenting two stimuli. Whereas in the previous test, what we were doing was we were putting a single object and we were dissociating the eyes. Here we are not dissociating the eyes, we are giving separate stimulus to each eye. So we will get objective angle, subjective angle, and angle of anomaly would be objective minus subjective. So objective angle is the angle that we measure. Subjective angle is patient, he will tell. And the objective angle is difference between the two. So what would be NRC then? NRC minus subjective angle, which means that if subjective angle, so objective angle can be equal to angle of anomaly if subjective angle is zero and patient has no angle. If there is a subjective angle, which means you can see that there is an angle, and objective angle is equal to angle of anomaly, which means that there is total in sync, harmonious retinal correspondence. As much retinal correspondence has changed, as much is the objective angle, that is the angle of anomaly, then it is harmonious ARC. And when objective angle is more than angle of anomaly, it is in between the two, and then it is unharmonious ARC. Now, this is how we do after image test. So basically, you present one eye with one independent stimulus, which will be a horizontal line, and then you close that particular eye, and then you stimulate the other eye. And then you tell the patient to, you know, close the eyes and tell you what he sees. If he sees a cross in presence of ESO or EXO, then it is ARC. But if the both the eyes are straight and then he sees, so this is patient's view. So if the this is NRC, patient sees a cross, left eye is stimulated with a vertical line, right eye is stimulated with the horizontal line. Now, if this is the response, this is NRC. Now here you see, this is fovea. Now left eye is already stimulated here. Now this is the abnormal retinal point. So patient's eye is on that side. And here, this is the fovea. See, in after image test, fovea comes to the center. In extra foveal test, the extra foveal point is getting stimulated. But here, we are stimulating both eye fovea. So both eye fovea is getting stimulated, but there is abnormal retinal correspondence. So what happens is, in esotropia, you will see crossed diplopia. Why? Because this is the ARC point. And for this particular point, which is abnormal retinal correspondence, this is temporal to it. And so this will project it into the nasal field of the patient. And so patient will see it like a crossed image, like this. So left eye will project on the right side of the patient or temporal side of the right eye. And this will be crossed images. You cannot suppress after image test. So this is totally dissociated test. You're doing foveal test. You are presenting two separate set of stimulus to the eye. And that is where esotropia will have crossed image and exotropia will have uncrossed images. Another interesting test, which is a sensory test, but it is actually done in a motor way, is four prism base out test. Very, very wonderful test, mainly done to find out small central suppression scotoma. It is a very remarkable kind of test, and that is where we have to give full marks to all the mentors who thought about these tests. It's a amazing thought process, the way it has been devised. So we do a cover test to see if there is any orthotropia and if there is any deviation or not. Patient has anisometropia, and then we do cover test. We did cover uncover test. We did and then we do alternate cover test, and then a four prism test is planned to find out about bifoveal fixation. So here it is very important to bring the prism from up to down and not from out to in, because you may shift the image when you are bringing it from the horizontal side. Now what will happen when you bring a base out prism in front of right eye? What will happen is, if it is having foveal fixation, what will happen is it will move the eye. So this is just a small interpretation. What will happen is, it will show the result. Yeah, on putting four prism in front of left eye, the left eye adducts. But if you see, right eye did not show any deviation. Let us go back. I'm doing cover test, and then I will bring the prism. Yeah, I bring the prism. There is no movement whatsoever from the right eye. Whatever we see is because of the distortion of the prism. The the prismatic effect that our eye has, but his eye does not adduct at all. Whereas, so this means that right eye has a small suppression scotoma. Whereas if you see left eye, what will happen is the left eye will move slightly inside to take up the fixation, because the prism will bend the lights. Yeah, see, the left eye moves little bit, and then left eye moves, adducts, and because left eye adducts, right eye has to abduct because of Herring's law of equal innervation, and then right eye takes up a refixation movement. So this is how you do a four prism base out test. And then there are few tests to find out the depth of suppression. Not all patients have similar amount of suppression. So there are series of red filters, which are, there's like a prism bar. There are series of red filter which are arranged in a ladder, and these are placed against the fixing eye with increased density to know greater the number of layers, greater you go to see till the point left eye or other eye, non-fixing eye, starts seeing. So that is, that will tell how much dense the suppression is binocularly. So this is a binocular test. Now for stereo acuity also, we have two types. One is a three-dimensional Polaroid vectograph, and then there are random dot methods. Again, very beautifully designed tests. So this is basically a Titmus fly test. The fly basically is a gross stereo acuity test, and you just have to bring it in front of. So you have to use Polaroid glasses. One of the eye, like you get those glasses in nowadays in cinema halls, they are also Polaroid glasses. So the polarization is horizontally arranged in one eye and vertically in other eye. So if you don't use both eyes together, this particular fly, you cannot hold the wings or you cannot see it in three dimension. So basically the dissociation is through polarization of glasses, and then you move on to the circle. So basically the trick is to tell the patient that these are buttons and they can press it. So you ask them about it and you gradually move, and the key is there either on the backside of this Titmus fly test, or you have a separate paper. You can go up to 40 seconds of arc, and then these three animals are there, and one of the animals is popping out. So you have to tell the patient that one of the animals is towards you, so you can see that. But that is also slightly gross kind of stereo acuity, up to 400 to 100 seconds of arc. So the finest stereo acuity is through these circles, but there are some monocular clues in Titmus fly test. It's a good test, but it's a very good test, very handy, very quick test. But there are some monocular clues. TNO, on the other hand, again, very old test. I think the book says it was, I have seen that it was in 1978 to 80s that it was made. Basically, you dissociate the two eyes with the help of red-green glasses. This is, 100% dissociation. So the first three plates will give you gross stereo acuity, and then it goes to finer and finer stereo acuity till 15 seconds of arc. It consists of a total of 7 plates. This is, I think, second plate. And then you have those Pokemon kind of structures, and you go up to 15 seconds of arc, and there are absolutely no monocular clues. And then there is Lang stereo acuity, which is Lang 1 and Lang 2. Basically, the target is seen through each eye. Built-in cylindrical elements are there, which basically dissociate the eye in such a way that one eye gets one image and other eye gets other image. And so there is Lang 1, Lang 2. Lang 2 can go up to 200 seconds of arc. This is Lang 2, where the star is always visible. And then there is, so Lang 1 will have a cat. Lang 2 will have a moon. Moon will have 200 seconds of arc. And there is a jeep here, which is obviously not visible because this is a two-dimensional picture. But if you feel that child is, this also has little bit of monocular clues, but you don't need a glass. So you can use it very, very quickly. So what you can do is, if you feel that the child is, this is also not, these are all not true stereo acuity. There is some amount of dissociation which is being used. But if you feel that child is playing with you, you can tilt it vertically at 90 degrees. And now the images are separated vertically. that we don't have vertical stereoacuity, and you can find out whether child is playing with us or not. Now, Frisbee test is another very marvelous, very well-designed test. This has three transparent plates. So this is the thickness of the plate. This is 6 millimeters, 3 millimeters, 1.5 millimeters. Now, target is printed on one side of each plate. So this is true stereoacuity. So these particular things, one is on one side and the target is painted on the other side. So without having actual stereoacuity, this is real stereoacuity. You don't need glass for this, as you don't need glass for Lang stereo test, but still it has got cylinders fitted on the top of it, which dissociate the two eyes. This is true thickness, which measures it, and you can adjust the distance. So a tape comes with it where you can adjust the distance. So the stereoacuity changes the moment you change the distance of that plate from the patient. So it is very important to always write at what distance we have checked that stereoacuity. Most of the tests are made for 40 centimeters. Now, we had made a theorem. I'm not writing or talking about that theorem, but we had made a theorem which could tell you how much is the amount of stereoacuity depending on the amount of dissociation, like you have these thickness of plates and the distance that it has from the patient. So that can be used. And this is for distance stereoacuity. So most important area where distance stereoacuity is important is in intermittent exotropia, because we know that, you know, patient gets dissociated in distance, and intermittent exotropia gets manifested very commonly in distance because patient is not able to fuse. And these patients can be found out easily on distance stereoacuity, what kind of or how much stereoacuity they have. And this is another Frisbee Davis 2 FD2. You can see that this is another test which is true stereoacuity. So what they do is, this is basically a blank, so that patient is not able to know. And this is basically, there are four objects. And then one of the object can be pulled from the center to closer to the patient. These are fitted, four objects are there. You can pull out one of them. Patient doesn't have to use glass. He just has to tell which particular image is there. And markings are there on this particular thing. And you can tell how much is the stereoacuity depending on the distance from this particular image to the patient and the marking. So they have a chart of the whole thing. And then there are similar to what we already saw, Polaroid glasses with Rendot stereoacuity, which has, they dissociate with the help of Polaroid glasses. You can do this at a distance of 3 meters. And this was, I could get as to what is the normal stereoacuity. This is for distance. I mean, I was also surprised that people can have such a fine stereoacuity for distance, but this was published. And another very underutilized tool, and this is my second last slide. So another very underutilized tool, this was published by Sharma sir, who can talk more about this, but it's a crude test, but it's a wonderful test for gross stereoacuity, where patient is not cooperating and we want to find out that, you know, what is a stereoacuity. So you can do a two pencil test. It could be vertical, it could be horizontal. So in the article, Dr. Sharma says that you should be used horizontal because it is possible that patient can get some monocular clues because the examiner is holding this particular pencil, and in horizontal two pencil test, the clue is not there. So it's another very good test where you tell the patient to take a pencil and try to match the two tips. And this has a threshold value of 3000 to 5000 seconds of arc, but it gives you a good idea that patient has some gross stereoacuity. So that was all regarding stereoacuity and binocular vision. This is a small video. I always felt that strabismus is more or less in the brain, and this was a great movie by Jet Li and Donnie Yeh. So the fighters basically do not really fight, but they test each other in the mind itself. So this is how stereoacuity and stereopsis and strabismus are. Most of our decisions in strabismus are already thought pre-op. We know, what would happen, so this is how we fight battles in our mind. This is how strabismus is. And, we try to assess what will happen? Should we leave slight under correction? If it is whether we should do over correction, if the patient is young, we may do some under correction in congenital exotropias. If there is intermittent exotropia and patient is around 15 to 18 years of age, we may do a small over correction. We know that these are all, this is not really a cosmetic surgery. This is not, we are not fixing a diseased muscle. Most of the muscles are normal. Just their anatomical alignment is not proper. We do not weaken the muscle. We just reposition the muscle. So a lot of these things used to fit. And so I try to make it in the video. So most of the things are in the mind. We try to plan out everything. And the thought process, once finished, we move ahead and finish off the misalignment. So that's all. And I would like to thank Dr. Sharma, sir, also. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. That last bit was really interesting. Any comments from you, sir, Pradeep Sharma, sir?
I think it was... the final finale, we may say, we have been having four previous theoretical talks on binocular vision on the various aspects. And today we had a clinical evaluation of binocular vision and stereopsis, very nicely presented by Dr. Jitendra. So he has given to us various tests which are there. If there are any specific questions, first we can take those.
Yes, sir. We have a few questions, sir, from the portals. Should assessment of stereopsis be made a part of routine clinical exam in all patients?
Of course, I would say yes. I mean, there is no second thought about it. So most of the patients, at least a quick, the most easiest way to do it is either use a Lang's test, so you don't need glasses for that, and then you can have at least a good idea of whether there is any, like Lang would test up to 200 seconds of arc, so it is quite good. So most of our patients, we test for stereocrity, but maybe I have a predominantly pediatric often service first practice, but we do it in all the patients, everybody.
The stereopsis, I would say, is the final goal of each and every ophthalmologist, whether he is treating a cataract or a corneal problem. The final goal is to achieve not just 6x6 vision in each eye, but to get back the stereopsis. So I think that is something which we may pick up many more things. So if your patient has got 6x6 in each eye, but not got stereopsis, you have not achieved the final goal that is required. Today only I remember I saw a patient who was actually a malingering person. It was sent to me as a retrobulbar neuritis with counting finger vision in one eye and 6x6 vision in the other eye. And the other ophthalmologist had mentioned it as a retrobulbar neuritis, obviously, because nothing is seen in the disc. Unfortunately, the pupils were dilated. So I think that parameter of having a RAPD also was missed. So this is what was mentioned as that. So the moment I did a stereo test, the person was not aware that in this both the eyes are required. I talked to her that, look, you are able to see with one eye? She said, yeah. So okay, I'll just be testing your eye. I put on the red and green glasses, the TNO test, and she was giving me all 60 seconds of arc with counting finger in one eye and 6x6 in the other eye. Obviously, she is a malingerer. VR also, the other doctor had done. And the VR also, interestingly, can be fallacious. In the sense, if you have a pattern VR, you may have increased latency. But the flash VR in that case was normal, but pattern VR was abnormal, which the ophthalmologist had probably not paid attention to. So sometimes you can pick up just by a simple subjective test in to know whether a person is malingering, even in non-strabismic situations. So, and then the other situation is a person coming of pseudo squint. Now, sometimes you are in a problem. You don't know exactly, maybe a little squint or not, and how to convince the parents that, okay, this is not really a squint. So if you do a stereo test and you have the child telling stereopsis being normal, you are 100% sure. I can tell you, my own daughter, I mean, she was supposed to be having pseudostrabismus. And when she was presented, I mean, Now, to convince your wife that yes, it is not, she'll say, no, but it looks like a true squint. So how to say that? Unless you do a stereo test and show that, look, binocular vision is 100% there. This is just a manifest esotropia. So the moment, and a 3 year, 4 year old child can do a stereo test possible. And even younger children, like 2 or 3 years, I have done the Lang's 2 pencil test, and it is very nicely possible to play with them, and they will tell you. So if you see them coming, giving the point to point connection, then you're sure that whatever the eyes may be appearing, it's aligned and it's giving them stereopsis.
So next one is, I think, how do we decide upon which test of stereopsis is to be considered in a given patient?
So I think what happens is that, gradually you, in your own practice, gradually you fall for some of the tests. Like, so for me, what I do is Lang 1, Lang 2 is there with the optoms also, and it is there in my cabin also. So the moment patient comes, we do Lang 1, Lang 2, and we find out whether they have any stereoacuity or not. Now, Lang 2 has a limitation that, you cannot go beyond 200 seconds of arc. So then you can go for Frisbee. But I'm not saying that, the Titmus fly test or whichever stereo test you have, see, you have to understand the limitations of all the stereo tests, and then you can do whichever. So I do Lang 1, Lang 2, and Frisbee. So most of my work is on Lang 1, Lang 2, and then Frisbee, that's it. For near, I meant for near. For distance, I, at this point of time, do not have, I had FD2. I really don't have FD2 right now. But for distance, I don't need much. But sometimes when I need, I have my own designed stereo test, which I use. So it is on red and green dissociation.
I would say that the TNO for near is probably one of the most sturdiest tests. We have seen with the Rendot, we may have issues. Many of the smart kids will be able to fool you because they can see the monocular clues on the word four circles. So these are even visible if you're careful. You can see with one eye also, you can see little shadowing of these circles. So they will be able to identify that circle which is there. So, but with the TNO, there is a total dissociation with red and green, and you would never miss a stereopsis in the wrong way. So for near, my choice is the TNO test, which is I have found better than Rendot, although it's more popular in US, the Rendot is being used, but I find the TNO is better. As far as the real stereopsis tests are concerned, whether it is the FD2, that's for distance, Frisbee-Davis for distance, FD2, or the Frisbee-Davis for near, the problem with them is that you have to be careful while doing. Because in that, if again, the child is smart, with a slight movement, he can judge by parallax, which is the point, out of the way stereo card, and he will be able to tell you. So you have to be very careful that you're not allowed to move the head. The parallax should not be used to tell you that, okay, there is a depth perception difference. So real depth tests are having that problem. The distance tests have the advantage that they may pick up the stereo problem earlier because in intermittent exotropia, as Dr. Jitendra was highlighting, that earlier problem will be in the distance stereopsis. But yes, practically, most of the clinics may not have the FD2 test, and we cannot recommend that to be done. It's more of an academic exercise. But yes, if you do the TNO test, you may see that, yes, definitely then the surgery is indicated.
So next one is, can you please elaborate on the concept of monocular clues?
So what happens is that when we are making a stereo test, so basically when you design a stereo test, you have to dissociate the two eyes. You have to make sure that both the eyes see the image from a separate angle. And the amount of dissociation, the amount of dissociation between the two images is what, and the distance of yourself from that particular image would tell you how much is that, how much that image has stereoacuity. So when you are trying to dissociate, there will always be that second particular image, like Sir said about Rendot or most of the Polaroid tests. So most of these Polaroid tests will have a small image. Now this particular it was the monocular close was regarding the stereo test or monocular close in life? I mean, the question was with regards to stereoacuity. Because it's a separate monocular close in real life is a separate separate discussion. So I was trying to highlight that in stereoacuity tests, you can have certain monocular close, which are basically a small shadow. And you know, when you see like in Titmus fly test, there are four circles. And you basically ask the patient which particular circle is either popping out or you can press it or it sounds or seems little different. That particular circle will actually be an amalgam of two images. Because if it is two images, only then you can actually have a depth perception. So this particular shadow or this particular shadowing is what gives monocular clues to the person who is seeing these. Whereas in TNO, they have made the test in such a way that there are absolutely no monocular clues. So I hope if sir can help me more.
I think what Dr. said is right, that monocular clues while doing these stereo tests are being, because in the Polaroid you are having two images which are still visible even with one eye, so there can be there because they are not on a random dot pattern. The tests for the word for grading the stereopsis on the rand dot, unfortunately, is not on the random dot background, while the gross tests are on the random dot background. But in TNO, even the grading tests are on the random dot background. Random. That's why these two images are actually not visible to either of the eyes seen individually. So that is the beauty of the TNO test, that the random dot background is taking care of the monocular clues. In cases of the real depth test, the monocular clues are because of parallax. So the moment you move, you can see that it's
on the side.
Different thing, image. So that's a parallax. So what Dr. Jitendra was saying, that yes, monocular clues in other sense, that they are giving you the non-stereopsis 3D vision. Like in a painting, you see that the images which are coming closer appear to be further away. The railroad, if you see in any painting or in real life also, you'll see that the railroads are coming narrow, becoming narrower or closer. It means that they are farther away. The blurred vision of the mountain tops is indicating that they are higher.
Posterior.
So any size is another way of giving the monocular clues. The same object which is shown as bigger will appear to be closer. So these are all the monocular clues which are there. Zooming in also is there in a car, like moving. We can see that it's zooming. So that again is a monocular clue that, okay, it's coming closer. So there are these things we have to be careful about. And you may have seen, by the way, that there are some street painting artists who can paint, although it appears like a 3D vision, it's not. It's just because of the painting, the using the highlights, the shadows, and the overlapping of the contours, which are the other monocular clues.
Correct. Another question is, can you comment on anisocornea and stereoacuity? How much can be tolerated by the patient? Anisocornea.
So I don't have a real figure in my mind how much they can tolerate, but I think up to 4 to 5 diopters of anisocornea, or rather anisometropia, they can tolerate. But it is very variable. It depends from patient to patient. So I would say that up to 3 diopters, most of them would be able to bear the change in the size and shape due to the refractive error. But more than 3 diopters, some patients may be able to, you know, fuse the two images, but their stereo would definitely suffer. They may have fusion, they may have stereoacuity, but they may not have as good stereoacuity as a normal patient may have. So 3 to 3.5 diopters would be easily fusible with most of the patients. But some patients, they are having an isometropic amblyopia, they improve, and then they complain of diplopia. And sometimes, you know, they are very happy when they have the same huge anisometropia from childhood, they're able to fuse it with good vision.
I think that's correct. 7% when they say anisocornea may be giving you the fusion ability and stereopsis. And that actually correlates with 2.5 to 3.5 diopters. 5 to 7% or 2.5 to 3.5 diopter difference between the two eyes of an isometropia.
Can it be a challenge, like if it happens after refractive surgery, like if a patient undergoes like a refractive surgery, And if
it would be and he's going to tell you that. Okay, so in once they have binocular, good binocular vision, and this happens post-surgery, they're going to complain of double vision. They're definitely going to complain. It would be very difficult for them to fuse at an adult age. Mm-hmm. So most of us are into pediatric ophthalmology, so we take it for granted that it was there. I mean, anisometropia was there, and the child has been doing this since years. So in refractive surgery, some patients are very sensitive. Even one diopter, they say that, you know, they can see an image and they can actually see a ghost image. So they do complain. Even with higher order aberrations itself, they complain. Even when they don't have an actual refractive error, with higher order aberration itself, they start complaining that they can see ghost image. So that ghost image is actually the difference in size and shape, if it is because of anisometropy.
The only issue is that the spectacle versus contact lenses versus the refractive surgery, the anisocornea is better tolerated because the magnification factor is maximum with the spectacles and lesser with the contact lens and least with the IOL, which has been there. So that's what, because it is correcting it at the closer to the nodal point. So the magnification effect is less. So the in fact, one of the treatments for anisocornea is to give contact lenses if there is a high refractive error difference. So if we have unilateral high myopes, we treat for amblyopia with the spectacles for a short time, but then switch on to contact lenses so that they can better tolerate the anisometropia and subsequent anisocornea becomes less. Mm-hmm. So refractive surgery again is an advantage that it will correct the magnification factor better and it will be better tolerated than what it was with the spectacles.
And this is a practical question. I hope I put it across correctly. The viewer asks, if a patient with a wide angle alternating exotropia having suboptimal but equal vision in both eyes, can he take up microsurgery after he undergoes surgical correction for misalignment?
Now, say again, it was wide angle?
Wide angle exotropia with suboptimal binocular vision or suboptimal monocular?
Suboptimal but equal vision in both eyes. Can he take
large angle exotropia with equal vision both eyes, and after surgery, will he be able to have binocular vision or not?
Okay. Mm. Can he take up microsurgery?
Jitendra, you want to take that answer? Yeah. First.
I mean, post-surgery, if he has good stereoacuity, why not? He can, of course, take up. And most of these patients, the best part of, the best part and the worst part of intermittent exotropia is actually the same. The intermittent exotropia, most of the times, they are intermittent. So, most of the times they are good. They are able to fuse well. They have good stereoacuity for near. Only in distance, as sir also said that, you use Frisby-Davis test mainly for distance. So if there is intermittent exotropia, even large intermittent exotropes, most of us who are doing strabismus know that even up to 50 prisms, they are able to fuse remarkably well. Sometimes if you're not a strabismus person, you may end up into telling the patient that you don't really have strabismus. They are so good, they can fuse so well. So for near, they always have a very, fairly good amount of stereoacuity. In fact, I would say that I wouldn't be surprised if they have around 40 seconds or 60 seconds of arc. So post-surgery, if they have good stereoacuity for near, why not? I mean, I think they can definitely take up surgery.
The key point which Dr. Jitendra is highlighting is intermittent. If there is a wide angle exotropia since, let's say, earlier than 1 year of age and there was no intermittence, then these people may not have any binocular-driven cells in the cortex. So they, like the infantile exotropes. So if that is a situation, they will never have stereopsis. Similar to the infantile esotropes if they are operated late. So the same way the infantile exotropes also, if you are operating late and they do not have any binocularity, then they are not going to regain. Sometimes we do have a problem that they have unfusible diplopia also. So because
diffusion suppression syndrome,
it's also an issue that has to be taken into account. So if they have been intermittent for some time, and if you can document that, yes, they can fuse even for near for short time also, then the prognosis is better. But if they do not have any intermittence in the history and they have been a constant exotrope, large angle exotropia, we may have to be telling them that, look, binocular vision may not be there.
And the last question for the day is, can you please explain the quantification of stereopsis?
Okay, Okay, so
it's in seconds of arc. It's a disparity.
So basically, you go ahead, sir. I will just show a slide afterwards.
Okay, you just put on the slide. So basically what you're seeing is the horizontal disparity between the two eyes in the measure of the angle. It's the angular disparity which we are measuring. So that's why it's in seconds of arc. Remember, when we are talking of 1/60th of a degree is 1 minute, and 1/60th of a minute is going to be 1 second. So this is 1/360 of a degree. That is what we mean by seconds of arc. So that much is the angular disparity between the two images which are supposed to be seen in the Panem's area to be fused. So I think Dr. Jitendra is showing you a picture. So when we are actually devising these tests, so then we use these measurements, the angular disparity between the two in the terms of tangent of that theta, and we can calculate.
Yeah, exactly. So this was something we had made our own stereo test when I was doing my fellowship. So these are two images. Basically, what we did was we photoshopped and put red filter in one of the images and green filter in another of the images. If you see this particular image with the help of a red green glass, you will be able to appreciate that it has depth. How much depth it has, that is the question. Like, how do you quantify stereo acuity? As sir said, you go from degree to minute. So one degree will have 60 minutes and 60 minutes will have 60 seconds of arc. So finer the seconds, finer the amount of disparity. And if you can catch that little bit of disparity also, it means that this is very gross stereopsis. In most of the movies which we go, it's very gross. And so you can see that image is coming very close to you, or if somebody's shooting a bullet, it is coming close to you. It means that they are using huge means very low stereo acuity in terms of from our side. So if you take this as a point, and this is the separation between the two images, you can measure it, as sir said, as an angle theta, you can measure it. And for 40 centimeters, we normally use 40 centimeters. So this is the theorem. You can just straight away multiply it and you can find out what would be the seconds of arc stereo acuity. So with the help of this, you can easily quantify how much seconds of arc stereo acuity we are talking about. So more finer the stereo acuity, higher the stereo acuity it is. Smaller the number, greater the stereo acuity.
The finest that we are testing is 15 seconds of arc. But majority of the people I have seen by the TNO are passing 60 seconds of arc. Some do 30 seconds of arc. Very few are actually getting a 15 seconds of arc stereo acuity. So I think mostly the norm, you may say, is for 30 to 60 seconds of arc on the TNO. And on the red dot, they usually say 25 to 50 seconds of arc, which is there in the red dot test.
I think that makes it very clear. With this, we wrap up our session, sir, for the evening today. Thank you so much to Jitendra, sir, for taking out his valuable time to be with us today. And to Pradeep Sharma, sir, for his valuable inputs and insights always. Santosh Noah, sir, is also here. Thank you for this wonderful initiative and organization of this iFocus. Sir, any concluding remarks from your side, Pradeep Sharma, sir?
I think once again, I would like to thank you, Shefali, for managing, moderating these sessions so nicely.
Dr. Jitendra, for give us confidence whenever you come online.
So of course, we would like to thank again and again Dr. Santosh for making this thing possible. So I think that is something which is going to be a great treat for each and every postgraduate all over the world. Thank you, Santosh.
Thank you, sir.
We'll meet on coming Wednesday, that is August 3. The topic is Amblyopia, Pathogenesis, Terminologies, Clinical Features and Evaluation by Dr. Subhash Dadeya, sir. So see you all on the coming Wednesday.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, Shefali.
Thank you, sir. Good night.